Hi. Hello, welcome back. This is Let's Talk About Myths, Baby. I'm Liv. I like to talk about myths. I like to tell you about them. I like to share them with the world because, my God, they're insane. How did they ever come up with this stuff? It's ridiculous. Now, where were we? Well, long story short is that there was a baby born. He's named Hercules. Ha! I said Hercules. He's named Heracles. What did we talk about last week? Anyway, that leads me to, you know him better as Hercules. As I mentioned last week, his Greek name is Heracles, his Roman name is Hercules. The Roman became more famous, but the Greek came long, long before the Roman, so we're going with it. Again, I didn't create the confusion, but I am sorry for it. I'll be calling him Heracles because that was his name for hundreds of years before the Romans came up with Hercules. So, baby was born. He was yet another child born to Zeus and a mortal woman. Hera found out. She was pissed. She worked her magic and basically made it so that Heracles was subject to another descendant of Perseus, Eurystheus. Heracles was, of course, a descendant of Perseus both by being Zeus's son and, grandson of Perseus? Is that it? I don't know. Listen to last week's episode. The point is, Heracles was related to Perseus, and as was this man, Eurystheus, who Hera made it so that Eurystheus was basically Heracles' boss. Athena then made it so that Heracles was superhuman by having him breastfed as a baby by Hera, and Hera proceeded to make it her life's work to make his life difficult. And so, Heracles is, by way of our favorite Greek mythology trope, an oracle prophecy, indebted to Eurystheus. Eurystheus must set him up with super duper hard labors, and Heracles has to go do it. Where we left off, Heracles was just told about his first labor, defeating the Nemean lion. A lion who is both the offspring of the crazy awesome monster the Chimera, and bred specifically by Hera to be a foe to Heracles. And with that, this is episode 17, Heracles or Hercules, part 2, The Gospel Truth. So Heracles is up against the Nemean lion. I'll remind you that its thing was that it was impenetrable. You could not pierce its skin. Not only that, but weapons would just bounce right off it. See, Heracles was famous for carrying around a club made of olive wood. It's his thing. You see a guy in ancient Greek iconography, sculptures, or whatever, carrying a club, it's probably Heracles. As a person obsessed with olives, olive trees, and everything in between, that's a little bonus just for me. But here, the club did no good. It would just bounce right off the lion's back in what I can only imagine would have been quite the comedic fashion. Knowing this, Heracles thought about his options. There weren't many, it seemed pretty clear that weapons were useless. So Heracles decided his brute, godlike strength was his best bet. He wrapped his arms around the lion's neck and wrestled the fuck out of it until finally, after quite the struggle, he strangled the lion to death. Then, because humans are gross, he used the lion's own claws to flay itself. And I think those of us who watch and or have read Game of Thrones know what that means. It's nasty. And anyway, he uses the lion's claws to cut its own skin off because, you know, that was the only way you could do it. Weapons couldn't pierce it, but its own nails could. Sounds like trouble waiting to happen. And so he took the thing apart and made himself armor from the upper part of the lion's jaw and head, wearing it as a kind of hood and cape of skin down his back. Kind of like those weird hood hat things that were popular a while back, where it looked like you're wearing an animal on your head with paws on your hands and everything. I never really understood the appeal, but maybe these people were just super into Heracles. But probably not. For his next labor, Eurystheus sent Heracles to kill the Hydra, sometimes called the Lernaean Hydra because it was near Lerna. The Greeks were nothing if not descriptive. Nemean lion by Nemea, Lerny and Hydra by Lerna, you never wondered where this stuff was going down. Like the Nemean Lion, you'll remember the Hydra from the Monster Mash episode. Hydra's one of my faves, and not only because it's a mythological reference in the Marvel Cinematic Universe, but that helps. The Hydra is a snaky water monster that was also apparently nurtured by Hera in an attempt to use it as a means to an end of Zeus's offspring, but specifically Heracles. Which leads me to wonder what on earth made Heracles so special. Was it just that this was the final straw for Hera? Why was he any different from the many, many other heroes that Zeus has spawned with women that weren't Hera? I mean, Hera, I hate to break it to you, but Heracles ain't the only baby Zeus had with another woman. One of many, to say the very, very least. Anyway, regardless of this logic issue, Heracles was the one that Hera wanted to ruin. And she planned to do so with a collection of monsters, including both the Nemean Lion and the Hydra. And maybe more, I'm writing as I go. You'll find it when I do. Now, the version of the myth I'm reading currently, again, thank you to The Greek Myths by Robin Waterfield, has the Hydra with 9 heads. Frankly, I don't remember how many heads I said it had in the Monster Mash, but also it doesn't matter because these things change depending what you read. Comes with the territory when you're talking myths that are thousands of years old and sometimes predated the written word as we know it. It's like an ancient game of telephone, but with everything. The Hydra was also notoriously poisonous, on top of having 9 snake heads. Really quite pleasant. So Heracles went at it, with the serpent snapping and hissing and spitting venom, and he cut off one of the heads. But if you'll recall, the greatest trick of the Hydra is that when you cut off one head, 2 more grow in its place. So after a few quick and slimy decapitations, suddenly this thing has even more heads, as if 9 weren't enough. And to add insult to literal injury, when Heracles started to attack this Hydra, one of its friends showed up. The Hydra lived in a swamp, you see, and it wasn't alone. A giant and very angry crab scuttled out of the swamp and began to attack Heracles. And yes, it was also raised by Hera for this exact purpose. Seriously, she went all in on this plan. But this crab didn't last long. Heracles took one look at it, scoffed, or so I imagine, and slammed his famous club down on its head. Due to his super strength, this was enough, and the angry and now very sad crab was left pinching in death. Hera, who we are told was a particular fan of the angry large crab, was so fond of it that she turned it into a constellation after its death. It's the constellation and the zodiac sign Cancer, which I am, and I didn't even know it came from Greek mythology, and frankly, I'm a little ashamed of myself. By the way, I plan to do at least one, if not more, episodes on the constellations and where in Greek mythology they came from, because almost all that we know are from Greek mythology, and that is pretty damn cool. But I digress. Now that Heracles has defeated the crab, he can turn his attention back to the Hydra. And thankfully, there is one final trick, and Heracles knows it. See, while most of the Hydra's heads are immortal and have that nasty habit of doubling up when one is cut off, there's one head that is in fact mortal and is the key to defeating the Hydra. So Heracles knows this, though he doesn't know which head. So he needs to find a way to get rid of all the other heads to figure out which will actually kill it. But he can't do it alone. Heracles realizes that there is just no way he's going to be able to kill the Hydra by himself. It's massive, its body is impenetrable, as are most of these ancient monsters, as it turns out, and my god, it just has so many heads. So he goes to get his friend Aeolus. This is his nephew, son of Iphicles, and he's loyal AF. Heracles knows Aeolus will help him out. So he gets him, and thankfully, Aeolus was only at their camp, so Heracles didn't have that far to go, and the two go back to the Hydra to double-team it. Had to. Heracles and Aeolus use their skills to do a little battle-style dance around the Hydra. Heracles will cut off one of the heads, and before it can split off into 2 new ones, Aeolus is right there to sear the bloody stump with a flaming torch. That way, it stays dead. And finally, after much of this, because remember, Heracles had already cut off at least one, maybe more of the heads, meaning it had already doubled up at least once. So there are a shit ton of heads. They are finally down to the last one. So Heracles knocks it off and Keep in mind he's been decapitating this thing with a club, which I find kind of baffling, and they bury this head under an enormous rock. So finally, this monster is just a ginormous body with a collection of seared stumps. Super pleasant. It's oozing blood and poison, and seriously, it must have been truly lovely to look at, not to mention to smell. It's writhing around like, for lack of a better term, a chicken with its head cut off. Heracles can even see the venom leaking out and into the water they've been fighting in. And he takes this opportunity to dip some of his arrows in the poison. He's a thinker. And so, with the Hydra now defeated, Hera once again places it in the sky as a constellation, which I also didn't know. It faces the crab, Cancer. Now, the third labor. In this case, Eurystheus asks Heracles to go and get a hind that lived on Mount Caronia in Arcadia. And if you're anything like me, you might ask, what the actual fuck is a hind? And you might want to assume it's a monster, like the Nemean lion or the Hydra or even the giant crab. Well, according to Wikipedia, you'd be way off base because, as it turns out, a hind is just another name for a deer. I guess way back, just like an adult male deer was referred to as a hart, a female was a hind. Kind of a bummer of a name, if you ask me. Heracles has to go and get this deer. Also, it has golden horns, even though it's a lady, so bonus precious metal. There's nothing particularly dangerous about the animal itself. It was where it was and who it was sacred to that was the issue. See, this deer was sacred to the goddess Artemis, and she took this very seriously. It's well known that anyone who fucks with this deer would face her wrath, and you remember what happened to Actaeon. At least I hope you do. I talked about it only last Friday. The point is, Artemis takes things very seriously, and she has no trouble sicking your own dogs on you and having them tear you to shreds just for seeing her naked, let alone if you steal her precious deer with the gold. For a good long time, Heracles chases this hind, looking for a way to capture it. There are lots of chances for him to kill it from afar with an arrow or something, but I guess Eurystheus wanted it alive because those weren't options, and this thing was bloody fast. So, thinking there was no way he was going to capture the thing at this rate, Heracles decides he'll just wound it, just enough to slow it down. So he does, and finally he's able to capture it. Now, I feel I would be missing out if I didn't point out that the guy can kill a Nemean lion, a zillion-headed hydra, and an angry giant crab, but he can't catch a deer? It seems questionable to me. Anyway, that was the case, apparently, so he injures it and finally he has this deer. But duh, Artemis catches him as he tries to bring the deer back to Eurystheus. She's all, what the actual fuck are you doing with my fancy deer? Heracles thinks quickly, figuring out that obviously his best bet to get out of this pickle is to reference the will of men, because patriarchy. So he tells Artemis that he was there on order of Eurystheus, that he was performing these labors for him on orders of the Oracle of Apollo, Artemis's own twin brother, and apparently this works, which I take issue with. I think Artemis would have said something along the lines of, fuck that, but apparently she didn't, or whichever man wrote it decided that she didn't. So that's three labors down. Heracles feels like he's really getting the hang of it. Zero to hero, baby. Next up, for his fourth task, he has to get a hold of a ginormous boar that's been kicking ass around Mount Erymanthus in Arcadia. This boar has been causing a real kerfuffle. Lots of blood and gore, I'm sure. On his way to the mountain, Heracles stops for a night at a cave. And it's not just any cave. That would be kind of weird. I'm sure there are better places to sleep, but this is a special cave because it's the home of a centaur named Pholus. And weirdly enough, it turns out that ages ago, Dionysus, the crazy god of wine, had stopped by to see Pholus and brought him a bottle of wine. But it was special wine, and Dionysus told Pholus that he wasn't to open it until Heracles comes for a visit. Pholus has more willpower than I because he keeps that promise and has a bottle of wine just sitting there waiting to be drank for ages. And finally, lucky enough, Heracles happens to stop by and Pholus says, "Hey, guess what? Wine. Let's get drunk." So they open this bottle of wine, but something I'm learning right now is that apparently centaurs have a real thing for wine, like a real thing, which makes me question even more how Pholus was able to keep the wine sealed for so many years, but that's neither here nor there. In this case, the smell of the wine when they open the bottle attracts all the other centaurs of Pholus's tribe, and they all try to get into this cave to get at that wine. Centaurs really could have used AA, just saying. The centaurs storm the cave. They are all about that wine. Heracles defends the entrance, though frankly I'm not clear why violence needed to be involved. Finally, having successfully beaten them back, many of the centaurs fled, and Heracles couldn't leave well enough alone, and he follows them. They've taken refuge with Chiron, super impressive centaur who trains heroes and is probably the vague inspiration for Phil in the Disney movie, only a centaur, which Phil is not. Heracles is uber mask, and so for no good reason, he attacks the centaurs in that cave. I mean, was he avenging the wine? Honestly, I have no idea why this would be necessary at all. And in the course of this very unnecessary battle, Heracles whips out his arrows. You remember, the arrows that he had dipped in the Hydra poison not too long ago? Deadly fucking arrows. And in this melee, Chiron accidentally gets pricked with one of these poison-tipped arrows. Heracles is very distraught that he's accidentally injured Chiron. It's a mystery why he felt he needed to follow the other centaurs, and seems only inevitable that something like this would happen. Regardless, Heracles is super upset. And sadly, Chiron is immortal, so the poison doesn't kill him, it basically just tortures him endlessly. Eventually, Zeus takes pity on Chiron and takes away his immortality, setting it aside for when Heracles would become immortal later on, and allowing Chiron to die. Frankly, this part is just sad. Heracles returns to Pholus's cave, having essentially decimated his race, only to find that Pholus has cleaned up everything, buried the dead, and is in that moment fiddling with one of Heracles's arrows. He's too late to stop him, and Pholus accidentally pricks himself with one of the poison-tipped arrows, and not being mortal like his brother Chiron, Pholus dies. And so, in one fell swoop, Heracles kills the two wisest and most wonderful of all the centaurs. That's our hero, ladies and gentlemen. Honestly, that part is just a bummer, so all apologies. I don't know why so many centaurs had to die. No wonder Bane and Ronan don't trust anyone outside the Forbidden Forest. I don't blame them. Now, where were we? Oh, right. The only reason Heracles got himself into this tragic mess is that he's on his way to his fourth task on Mount Erymanthus, where he is to capture the very angry and violent boar that has been terrorizing the land. This boar is apparently the size of a bull, and inexplicably, Eurystheus needs it back alive. Don't ask me why. Heracles tracks the boar, and they spend a couple of days playing metaphorical chess, or probably checkers. This thing is big, but it's still a boar. And Heracles just can't seem to catch it. It's a wily thing. Finally, Heracles comes up with a plan. See, they're way up in the mountains, so there's snow nearby. He tricks the boar into getting caught in a snowdrift, and there it stays still long enough that Heracles bops it super hard on the head with his club, and finally he can wrap it up all nice and tight in the nets he's brought with him and lug it back down to Eurystheus. Once Heracles gets the boar back to Eurystheus, it apparently makes such crazy scary noises, even when it's all wrapped up in Heracles' nets, that Eurystheus is so scared he runs and hides in a large storage jar. So I think that tells you something about Eurystheus and also about the size of storage jars that existed in ancient Greece. Impressive, to say the least. For his fifth labor, Eurystheus decides to really mix things up for Heracles. He sends him to the city of Elis, in the northwest of the Peloponnese. There, the king Augeas, this is me trying to pronounce words as I read them, the king Augeas reigns, and Augeas has quite the collection of cattle. Swimming in cows, you might say. And when one is swimming in cows, one is also swimming in something cows create quite frequently. poop. So Augeas has a lot of cows and therefore a large stable. However, he is not one to keep this stable in the tip-top shape it should be, and so it is, quite literally, full of shit. Heracles' job will be to clean out all that shit. Like I said, Eurystheus was mixing things up. And there's a little wrinkle in that Heracles not only has to clean up these massively disgusting stables, he has to do so in one day. So Heracles has to come up with some kind of solution to this very icky problem. How to clean up that inconceivable amount of shit in a single day? What is a hero to do? Well, this hero decides that he can divert to nearby rivers so that they rush through the stables and clear everything out. Now imagine if this were reality, this may have caused more damage than actually solving a problem, but who's to say? Perhaps this is magical water where it only cleans and doesn't tear apart buildings and other structures. In this case, Heracles apparently succeeds and the stables are clean. Now, in addition to needing these stables clean, Augeas has also apparently promised Heracles that he could have some of these cattle if he succeeds in mucking things out. Of course, Heracles does, but Augeas is suddenly quite fond of his cows and decides to go back on this agreement. Seriously, ancient Greeks loved them some cows. So Augeas took back his offer and instead drove Heracles out of the city. Oh, and he also drove his own son out of the city because he had apparently pointed out that his father was doing a shitty thing by going back on his agreement. And this man was the only man who didn't like hearing he was wrong. Heracles and Augeas' son Phyleus left Elis and went to the city of Olympia, where they were welcomed into the home of Dexamenus. In exchange for his hospitality, Heracles promises to do a favor for Dexamenus. Dexamenus' daughter was being harassed by a local centaur, Eurytion. My god, everyone's names sound exactly the same. Sometimes, dear listeners, I'm just as thrown as you are. Heracles promises that he would solve this problem, because he was now incredibly well-versed in the slaughter of centaurs. Even if he had apparently felt quite badly when he had done away with the centaurs earlier. I say apparently because in this case he seems quite keen to do this, and how does he do it? Well, he uses one of his tried and true poison arrows. They've killed centaurs before, why not do it again? And so Heracles completes his fifth task and kills yet another centaur as a bonus. He's off to the races. He heads back to Eurystheus, who I imagine is more and more annoyed every time Heracles succeeds with these maniacal tasks. Eurystheus assigns to Heracles his sixth task. He's to travel to Stymphalus in northeast Arcadia. There is a lake with mountains towering above and forests at its shores. Sounds beautiful, very Pacific Northwest. But here the forests were overrun by a very interesting type of bird. See, they could shoot their feathers like arrows. It sounds like something I'd like to avoid. It's bad enough when crows start cawing, swooping at you. It's not fun. Imagine if they could shoot their arrows. Heracles learns that they're not quite as tricky as they sound. Athena gives him a bronze rattle. Yes, a rattle, like with babies. And he hits it against a tree, making an awful noise and scaring the birds. They all fly up into the sky, and he shoots them down with his arrows. No recreation of Hitchcock here. Six labors down, halfway there. Next week, more tasks and more fascinating and entertaining stories of Hercules, whatever you want to call this, the most famous Greek hero. The final six tasks take Heracles all over the world, and even to the underworld itself. He heads to Crete and to Thrace, and even heads over to see Wonder Woman's mom, Hippolyta of the Amazons. Stay tuned. Well, my friends, there's part two of Heracles. Next week will be the final part of this Heracles series, with the last of his tasks taking him on many more adventures. Heracles' story is seemingly endless, so I'll leave even more to be told in the future. We'll finish off his tasks and leave the rest of his adventures for later in the podcast. Thanks to everyone for listening. As always, I'd be immensely grateful if you would rate, review, and subscribe on iTunes or Stitcher or wherever. Basically, the reviews and ratings and subscriptions on all platforms are the key. Also, as a reminder, I have a Patreon page. I'm currently sorting out the best Patreon-specific bonuses that patrons will receive, but at this stage, I'm aiming to record a bonus episode where I talk about the movie 300 and how it aligns and doesn't align with both ancient Greek mythology and the history itself, because, guys, that was a real battle. Not a sensational, perhaps, but a real battle. So if you become a patron and pledge just $5 a month, you'll be able to hear that exclusive episode. I'll add new things as I come up with them and new bonus episodes as the ideas arise. Thank you all again. You're all magnificent. Thanks to the people outside of the States and Canada who've been listening lately as well. Welcome. I hope my references make sense. I'm Liv. I have the gospel truth from Hercules stuck in my head. And I love this shit.